Hello, pod smashers of the internet, and welcome to another 80-bit newscast. We are a weekly video game news show bringing you the rundown of what has happened in the last week in the gaming industry as filtered by the things that we care about. And we have lots of fun things to talk about tonight. Penguin, what do we have?
So we are going to be going through a bunch of news stories and giving you our thoughts on them. So it's going to be, we're going to be opining, we're going to be punditing on our thoughts on these stories. But we're going to be talking about, we're going to talk a little bit about the GameStop stuff for those of you who are chomping at the bit to have us talk about that. We're going to talk a little bit about it. We're not going to spend all of our time there. We're going to be talking about some drama with the PlayStation Plus offerings for the month of February, which it is February now. Crazy. We're already the whole month behind us in 2021. There's some updates to a beloved PS4 game that will be having some PS5 enhancements. So we'll talk about that. A new dev studio for EA is making an exciting game. Returnal was delayed, so we'll talk about that. Stadia's first party proprietary studios are shutting down, so we'll talk about that and the impacts of that. And there's some other news stories that we may or may not get to. We will for sure get through those six things. If we have time for the rest of them, we will talk about them and we'll bring them up as we go. So that's the main stuff we're talking about tonight. So, Termite, I'll hand it over to you for housekeeping.
Housekeeping. I am your host, Termite, and that is Penguin. Penguin and Termite of 80-Bit Pod Smash. I hope I put it in the right direction. I didn't have you in front of me. And every single week, we have a weekly video game podcast that drops talking about the things that you care about with video games, where gaming goes to grab a beer. And that episode that just dropped this morning was on puzzle games, so make sure you go to 80bitpodsmash.com and check that episode out. It is episode 175?
Seven.
Holy cow! We have a lot of episodes of our show. We've been running for over 3 years, 3.5 years almost, and it's a great time. We have a great show every single week. You can look forward to it. Also, every single Monday night right here on twitch.tv/80bitpodsmash, we run you through the weekly video game news, and on Wednesday evenings at 8 p.m., we have a live gameplay stream. Termite is hitting the internet strong with a good, solid Sea of Thieves stream. I've been playing it on the side, and I am loving it. I am addicted to it. It is my favorite thing. Not to spoil a show in 2 weeks, that'll be a favorite things, but it is my favorite thing right now, and so I will be playing that on Wednesday night, twitch.tv/80bitpodsmash. Those videos go up to our YouTube channel, so make sure you go to 80bitpodsmash.com to get the link for that. If you're coming by way of us through YouTube, then make sure you subscribe to us on Twitch so that you can be made aware of when... Hit the bell so you're made aware of our comings and goings when we're live, because sometimes we like to surprise and delight our audience and go live with something fun that we're digging at the moment. I also want to take this time to plug our great friend Gordon, who has his own podcast called This Is Gonna Hurt. You can find it at anchor.fm/thisisgonnahurt. J. Gordon Duncan is the host of that podcast. He drops every week a show regarding faith, fitness, finance, and I'm missing one of the F's. Faith, fitness,
family.
Finance, family, thank you. And so various topics. He had me on the show to talk about GameStop, and the reason why I am plugging him now is because he is telling his audience about us, who we are, and we're trying to cross-pollinate some of our audiences to be more welcoming and opening to others and grow our spaces so that we can have and more connections with folks. And we're going to talk about GameStop. So it's a great segue to, if you want to hear more Termite's in-depth discussion about the whole situation regarding GameStop and the stock debacle, head on over to that podcast and listen to my almost hour-long discussion with Gordon over there. Friend of the show, so thank you for that invite, and I had a blast. It was super fun to be over there. It was a great discussion. So, without further ado, what do you want to talk about with GameStop?
Yeah, so for those who don't know, you should check out the happenings, the goings-ons with this. It really has very little to do with video games, if anything. Very, very little, if anything at all, to do with video games, which is why we're not going to spend a ton of time talking about it on this show. It is a financial discussion, so if we were a financial podcast or a podcast about investments, we would talk about it because it's really interesting nonetheless. But since GameStop is part of the story, we figured we'd at least mention it, just so that we wouldn't be accused of, why haven't you guys talked about GameStop? So anyways, the bottom line, we're not going to link off to an article or anything, we'll just talk about it. The bottom line is, GameStop was the target of a subreddit group called Wall Street Bets. I say target, and I mean that in the literal sense of just the focus, not in a negative sense. But there was a large hedge fund that was betting against GameStop, effectively, using short, I think it's called short betting or something like
short
that.
Short sales, yep.
Short sales, that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And they were basically betting that GameStop's stock was going to plunge. And I don't want to get into the mechanics of it because it's complicated, but the bottom line is this group of enterprising subredditors decided that they wanted to screw that hedge fund and started buying GameStop stock while it was relatively high, higher than it had been, which drove the price up, meaning that this company that was, this hedge fund that was of super rich people, hedge funds are super exclusive. You can't, no Joe Schmo can just contribute to a hedge fund like mutual funds. Hedge funds are only for the super rich, exclusive, wealthy elites. And they basically were like, this hedge fund just lost a ton of money. I think it lost something like $1 billion or something obscene, an absurd amount of money. They lost because they were betting that GameStop stock was going to plunge, but people on Reddit drove the price up.
Mm-hmm.
So crazy story that basically is this sort of David and Goliath tale of enterprising investors on the internet taking down effectively a big hedge fund that had to get bailed out. It's even more complicated by the fact that the app that was used for the investing, Robinhood, which makes it easy and accessible for individuals who especially aren't very experienced to invest. I've used it. It's fun. Robinhood like shut down and limited the sale, the purchase, further purchase of certain stocks in order to protect the hedge fund. So it's like, oh, you've got this company, this platform that's restricting the free market. It's crazy. Anyways, so mm-hmm. look into it. But again, very little to actually do with gaming. That's why we're not going to spend a ton of time here. But did you want to share some thoughts?
The last thing is the hedge fund is as easy as it is to make them out to be like the big enemy of the rich or the big enemy of the people because they consist of the elite rich. The hedge fund that did go bankrupt also contributes to a lot of mutual funds, which affects a lot mm-hmm. of people's retirements. And so they're in companies that do good in the world also have investments tied into the stock market. And so like the ripple effect of that goes beyond just this hedge fund collapsing because in order to bail that hedge fund out, a lot of other companies also had to lose money. And so it has crazy complicated rippling effects across the entire Wall Street.
A bunch of people made life-changing money. A bunch of people who are small, you know, who could also use that money. So it's not all white. It's not all black.
Right.
It's very morally gray, all things considered.
Mm-hmm. But nuts.
On both sides, but I don't know. I tend to lean towards against the super rich jerks who were basically trying to tank the stock. Mostly it's because like these guys manipulate the stock market with no consequences all the time. Right. All the time. Mm-hmm. As soon as it's done by, you know, your average Joe Schmo on the internet, they suddenly are like, we need to restrict this. It's like, no. It's a free market, and you have to suffer the consequences of your own actions sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nothing illegal was done in any of this. Yep. It was just a nuts story that
the only illegal thing was done by Robinhood shutting down and limiting the purchase of stocks.
Legally questionable. I guess it hasn't been
legally
proved.
Questionable.
Yes, hasn't been proved. Like charges haven't been made yet.
But court or anything like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I have a feeling that a court case is coming on because it's very, very questionable what Robin... Yeah, no laws were broken up until that point.
Mm-hmm.
It does bring into question, are the laws around stocks fair in that regard?
Oh, yeah, long-term change, is what regulations are going to happen now.
Yep. That will affect both the rich elites and the, enterprising individuals on the internet. So, anyways, anything else? Yeah, so again, nothing to do with GameStop. I don't even remember. Did GameStop make a response? Did GameStop make a
newsworthy. I haven't seen any headlines. I haven't done any research.
Can you
imagine usually that stuff trickles up.
Like, they're just the middleman. They're just like, we just happen to be the focus of And there were other stocks too, like AMC Theaters and some others that were being thrown around there too.
Apparently, AMC Theaters had a $600 million deficit because of COVID, and this whole thing actually brought them into the positive from $600 million hole. And so, like, I don't know what this means because the actual value isn't what it is. It's inflated. And same with GameStop. It's going down now. It's done. So it's plummeting back to its original value because they haven't done anything to sustain the high value. But anyway.
I don't even know, like, what's and that's why we're not going to talk too much about it, because I don't even know, like, what benefit having a high stock value necessarily has a company, other than people are giving you money. I don't know. Whatever. It's a whole thing.
Yep.
So, all right. Well, then we can move on now to stories actually about video gaming.
Yay!
So, our first story is about the Control Ultimate Edition, which was recently announced to be one of PS Plus's three offerings for the month of February. What's newsworthy about this?
So, just the actual news article that we wanted to not link off to, but talk about, was PlayStation Plus's offering for February. We do this every month. So, PlayStation Plus has, through its blog, has announced the PlayStation Plus free offerings for this month, and that is Destruction All-Stars, which was supposed to be a launch title, sold at $70, and they announced right before the PlayStation 5 came out that it was going to be a free PlayStation Plus offering in February. Fast forward 3 months, and here we are. We're getting it. I'm excited. It's like Twisted Metal meets Splatoon, parkour. It's going to be nuts. Followed by, this was the big surprise, Control Ultimate Edition, as well as Concrete Genie. So those three titles are the PlayStation Plus titles. I'm excited. It's a great day. It's all coming out tomorrow. But what the biggest thing about this is Control. 505 yes. Games, the publisher for it, earlier on was caught in a controversy when they said the upgrades to the PlayStation 5 version were not going to be free unless you purchase the Ultimate Edition. With that, people who had purchased the original PlayStation 4 version could not transfer their saves to the Ultimate PlayStation 4 version. So they were kind of gated. So if you didn't buy the Ultimate Edition back when, you were screwed out of your, quote, free upgrade, and you'd have to rebuy it. So that all that happened. And it was a very non-consumer-friendly move, and there was never any pushback. There's no result. 505 dug their heels in, and they didn't make any changes.
Yep.
So then, leading up closer to this release, it was scheduled to be released in February. No one had a clue it was going to be free on PlayStation Plus. People started buying the PlayStation 4 Ultimate Edition in hopes to get the free PS5 upgrade and transfer their save from the PlayStation 4 to the PlayStation 5. It was quickly debunked that you cannot transfer your game save. So people had bought the PlayStation 4 version of the Ultimate Edition of Control and are stuck with it. And then this happens. Where it's free, and
it's
no one can transfer.
For the month of February, for PS Plus subscribers. So
right.
A subscription that there's plenty of overlap on. So to repeat, because there's a lot of information, so just kind of like succinctly recap it. Basically, I am a player who wants to play Control on my PS5. My PS4 version, my disc, will not upgrade to the PS5 version. So 505 Games says in order to do that, you're going to have to buy a new copy of the game, the Ultimate Edition, and that's going to have the PS5 enhancements. The PS5 enhancements, which, though the game has already been out for months, does not release until tomorrow. So I, the person who theoretically wanted the PS5 version, bought the Ultimate, you know, stomached the cost and bought the Ultimate Edition, and have been sitting on it with my PS4 version right next to me, has been sitting on it for months now, waiting for the PS5 version to release. Suddenly, it's announced a month before that release, or not even a month, a few weeks before that release, it's announced, oh, you're getting it from your PS Plus subscription. So lots of people are rightly annoyed that they have basically, you know, spent their money for no reason.
Right.
Because they're getting it included in their cost.
Mm-hmm.
All that's just to say that, like, 505 Games, when they first announced it, cited some technical reason why they couldn't give the updates for free to people who already had it, which turned out to be bullcrap because they were caught in the lie because on Steam accidentally they released the, like it said, the, you know, re-release or Ultimate Edition became in people's libraries after they had not even bought it or something ridiculous. So they got caught in that lie too. So they're in hot water with their fans, which sucks because Remedy, the makers of the game, made an awesome game and they're great, but their publisher is just being really greedy and really, really making very anti-consumer decisions. They should offer, honestly, they should offer refunds to anybody who purchased it, period, who wants it. Like, I think that would be the only way to come back from something like that, opinion-wise. So,
yeah.
That's any other thoughts?
No, that's about it. Just kind of annoying. It's extremely exciting if you're interested in Control and you haven't played it yet.
I mean, I'm excited because I want to play the PS5 version, so I kind of lucked out being patient on this one, I guess, but I still feel bad for everybody who didn't.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, God of War is getting an update tomorrow. What's it going
to
do?
Yes, so tomorrow's continuing to be an amazing day for PlayStation owners as we just announced the PlayStation Plus game library. Now we get Santa Monica Studios has announced that God of War from 2018 is getting an enhancement patch for PlayStation 5. Tomorrow, February 2nd, we will be releasing a free patch that replaces the current video graphics mode option with a new default setting that will offer the best of both performance and resolution to our PlayStation 5 players. And that comes with 60 frames per second, 4K checkerboard resolution at 2160p.
I didn't understand what's the checkerboard resolution.
That's the methodology that the PlayStation 4 Pro used to get around some performance barriers to still actually have a 4K image. So it renders it at a lower resolution, but then checkerboards it up to scale it so that it looks presentable at 4K and you still get an amazing looking picture that's crisp and sharp, but it's not truly 4K. So the difference to that is the native 4K versus the checkerboard 4K. And I know Microsoft leveraged that terminology a lot in their competition back when they were doing the Xbox One X versus the PlayStation 4 Pro. You'd notice native 4K being thrown around all over the place. So I guess here, in order to get the full 60 frames per second, they still had to fall back to a 4K checkerboard resolution, but it's still presented to you at 2160p. So your TV will see it as a fully framed, legit, not scaled, actual 4K image. But the rendering solution is checkerboard.
Interesting. I thought 2160 was 4K, but
it is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. That's exciting. How is it any different from? You had mentioned that, if you install it and don't patch it on your PS4 from the disc, it runs at 4K. Is that the same thing, checkerboard 4K?
Yes.
Or is it...
The resolution was the same from the PS4 Pro. And what that was, unpatched, there was a... there was not a cap on the frame rate. And the PlayStation 5 hardware was able to just push the frame rate to the sky. And so it was oh, this is awesome. But back in the PS4 Pro, when it was released, that unlocked frame rate presented an uneven... a non-consistent frame rate. So it would go up and down and up and down based on what's going on. And they didn't have the resolution scaling to kind of smooth that out. So they just put a 30 FPS cap on the 4K. And that was what you had with the patch. So now,
you can patch it. You can update it. Yeah, you can have the best of both worlds without having to worry about... Yeah, sweet. I might just... See, because what I wanted to do was be lazy and just download it from the PS Plus collection instead of having to run it on my disc.
Yep, now you can.
And now I can do that. Yep. So, sweet. That's exciting. I'm stoked. I'm going to play the whole playthrough tomorrow. And the whole thing.
Continuing the good news trend, this will be a really fast just update. Tomorrow, The Division 2 is also getting its PlayStation 5 enhancement patch, so it'll also run at 4K, 60 frames per second, as well as all that Resident Evil news we talked about last week, the little crossover they're doing with Resident Evil items in-game. All that happens tomorrow, too. So, The Division 2, God of War, Control, Destruction All-Stars, and Concrete Genie are all landing on PlayStation tomorrow. It is such a crazy day. I wish I didn't have to work so I could just
I know.
Play.
I've got a really busy day at work. I'm not going to be able to play at all tomorrow. It sucks.
Same here.
Yeah. Yep. Crazy. All right, cool. Moving right along, checking through these news stories. The new dev studio for EA making the new Skate game announced last, and you don't have a... last word there on your sentence.
Yeah, because I wanted to fill it out with knowledge, and that knowledge is back in July during the Summer Game Fest through Jeff Keighley. EA had an event called EA Play. It's kind of their little E3 that they do for just EA, and in that was this one tiny little snippet between two folks talking about, we're making the game that everyone's clamoring for, Skate, and that was it. Obviously, somebody had a napkin idea, and that was as far along as it had ever gotten in production, and they announced it. So now we actually have, the first real tidbit of information about what's going on with EA's Skate. There's been three skate games that have come out through the Xbox 360, PS3 generation, and they are beloved by skateboarding fans post Tony Hawk. So the new studio is called Full Circle. It is a studio based in Vancouver with team members from around the globe, embracing a geo-diverse team and culture. They're about having fun and making great games that people want to play with their friends. They're working on the next evolution of skate and set to deliver an experience that will embrace and build upon everything our community found special about the previous games. And that's it. So the name of the studio is called Full Circle, and it's based in Vancouver.
Very cool. Full Circle is another way of saying 360.
It is. How about that?
Which is, you know, like a skateboarding move. It was a bad joke. It didn't land.
Nope.
Didn't land at all.
And what I read was from EA.com, so it was their press release straight up.
Yep, sweet, awesome. I have no comment other than bad jokes, so.
You never played Skate. That's why.
I never played Skate. They're so good. And, yeah, the last skateboarding game I played was one of the Tony Hawks. Yeah, so
it's good stuff.
They love you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Unless you have anything else, we can move on to the next story. Mm-hmm. All right, cool.
Move on.
Another game is delayed, but not by very long. Returnal, which was supposed to come out in March, I believe, is now been delayed to April 30th. Housemarque released a statement saying they were delaying it, and but it's not coming out. It's not too much longer for that one. But did you want to read the statement? Anything from the statement?
I just want to say that it was supposed to come out March 19th, so they pushed it a month and 10 days, a month and 11 days. But I wonder, and this is my pontification, if you will, or, you know, as a pundit.
I love it, pontification.
Is that I wonder if this is the Cyberpunk Fallout effect, where Cyberpunk limped out with all of their debacle and controversy with how non-quality it was. And Returnal is now like, and we're going to take another month because of how that went. And I wonder how many studios are going to be doing that, or if this was just a result of like COVID, which is pushing everything into next year. And
to me, the Occam's Razor settles in, and the explanation with the least assumptions is probably the right one. And I think at this point, the explanation with the least assumptions is not COVID.
Right.
Maybe both, though. It could be both. It could be like, well, we had COVID. This game is not in a state that we want it to be because of COVID. And we saw what happened to Cyberpunk. Let's not make that same mistake.
Yep.
I mean, considering it is the first non-remake PlayStation 5 exclusive game, right? Maybe Destruction All-Stars. I don't know.
We had Sackboy's Big Adventure, and we had Destruction All-Stars, and now this.
It's PS5 only. It's not cross-gen launch, so it's kind of a big. I mean, it'll probably be, you know, a solidly AA game, if you wanted to couch it in those terminology. But nevertheless, it's a highly anticipated game for, you know, that's exclusive to PS5 right now. So they probably want to make sure it comes out as close to their vision as possible. So I want to actually move something. We didn't say that we were going to talk about this, but because it's in our optional, but I want to move it up because I want to, since you brought up the idea of games not coming out all buggy and stuff, I want to talk about Biomutant. Was announced and was finally announced. This game has been in development hell for forever, and there's a reason for that, but they finally announced that its release date will be May 25th this year. The game was originally set to come out in 2019, so it's been delayed for a hot second. But there was an interview with the lead developer and for the project, and he said that they delayed. He confirmed that they delayed it because there were a lot of bugs, and they wanted to give quality assurance time enough to fix them all without crunching. That's so huge. They did not make their QA teams crunch. They recognize it. And so, like, how, here's, this is why I might buy this game, even if it sucks. I might buy this game on principle alone, because they like, if you compare it to like Cyberpunk, they recognized the game was a buggy mess. They recognized that they were going to need more time for the quality assurance teams to do it, and they recognized that they were going to have to, like, not crunch the heck out of their employees, so they just indefinitely delayed the game until it was ready. That's awesome. That's so good. That's like, that's amazing. So good on I think it's called Experiment 101 or something like that is the development studio that makes Biomutant. So I'm really, really proud of that decision. That hasn't necessarily sold me on the game, but I was already really interested in the game to begin with.
We frequently talk about how like we vote with our wallets. If companies are doing nefarious things or you don't like what they're doing, then don't buy their games, don't pre-order their stuff, and don't buy into the hype. And this is the opposite side of that. The game might not be that best amazing. You know, this could be another AA title that comes out and it's like it's good, but it's not amazing. But that incentive to then go out of your way to make sure you buy a full price copy directly from a retailer, not through a reseller, and make sure that that development studio gets your dollar for this, and like how much more it incentivizes you to buy it because they're doing humane things and humane practices in the workspace. Like, this is awesome. It's a great story.
And I mean, yeah, if it came out, if they delayed it because of bugs, then you know that it's probably going to come out in a pretty decent playable, at the very least a decent playable state, which is great. So, which is awesome.
It was revealed in 2017. It was supposed to come out in 2018.
I know. The game was been delayed so much, but
there was a hands-on PAX event back in 2018 where they showed the game off, and it did not look good. I was excited about the idea of this game, but when I saw it, I was like, nope, nothing looked good.
Yeah.
So I'm glad, you know, hopefully
the
3 years.
The combat looked fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. The combat looked good, but some of the like character models and stuff like that looks a little strange. So, anyways, yep.
That's a good story.
Yeah, all right, so last story that we have, so feel free to, if you are watching live, which I'm not sure anybody is, but if you are, this is the time to jot down your any final comments, concerns, questions, criticisms, trolling that you may or may not want to include on there. We will read it and discuss it before we finish off. But our last story that we have time for is the Stadia news.
Yes, so Google Stadia announced today, this is kind of late-breaking news today, that Google announced today that it was canceling multiple projects. Basically, any game slated for release beyond a specific 2021 window. They believed games close to release would still come out, but today brings some clarifications. Google will close its two game studios located in Montreal and Los Angeles. Neither had released any games yet. That closure will impact around 150 developers, one source familiar with Stadia operations said. The company says it will try to find those developers new roles at Google. Jade Raymond, the veteran producer who helped build Assassin's Creed for Ubisoft and moved on to EA several years ago before finally leaving to run game creation at Stadia, is also exiting the company. I remember that being a big deal. Like, oh, they brought in this guy, Jade Raymond. Maybe she. This person. I don't know the gender. This person from EA, like, oh, this is a big person. This is a big deal. And they're really building up and hyping up their gaming platform. I'm reading from Kotaku.com, by the way. So go check out Steven Totilo's article. And yeah, this is crazy. So Google Stadia was this streaming service that offered, of course, a platform for third-party publishers to push their games. So we have like Cyberpunk and whatever Ubisoft, you know, Assassin's Creed Odyssey was kind of tested during the release of this. But the whole promise of Google Stadia and what they could do that nothing else could was have this like zero to infinity number of players existing in a game at one time and be able to jump in and then have a streamer be able to see all of their camera views at the same time and interact with all of them and then be able to go to YouTube and like watch a video of it, but then jump into the game at any point, which would require, of course, exclusivity on Stadia because the technology in order to make that happen would have to exist there. All of that dream is gone. So we know Stadia didn't launch very successfully. There's a lot of catches and gotchas when it first limped out in the compatibility issues, and you couldn't play it like they promised across every device. You required certain hardware, and it has not been received well. And you don't have like a Game Pass service. You still have to buy the games, but also pay for the subscription service. And it got expensive, and it was bloated, and the messaging was convoluted. And now we're seeing that fallout. The writing was on the wall. This is bound to happen. They weren't making money, and now they're closing their game studios, and they've lost Jade Raymond.
Yeah, the service is still running, right? Like, if you bought the service, you still have access to Stadia and all your games on it. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how long that's going to last. That would make me worried if I was a Stadia subscriber. But, yeah, I mean, the pull of any gaming platform is its exclusives, right? What can I play on this that I can't play on anything else? And Stadia has none of that. I almost think that the reverse should have been done in regards to how Google launched their gaming platform. They should have 6-7 years ago launched a game studio developed games under the Google name, and then announced Stadia and said all of the Google games that you love are going to be exclusive to Stadia or whatever. You know what I mean? Like that seems to be like it would have been the smarter way of going about it, because now they're in the reverse. They were trying to fund their games with Stadia, but Stadia was a mess.
Yep.
And a failure. So, yeah, I guess you're right. This is inevitable fallout of their failure here. So, yep, nope. Google is not going to be the big name in gaming. They're not going to be the future of gaming. The three kings still wear their crowns, so to speak.
The last blurb I will read here from Kotaku is that Google will continue to operate the Stadia gaming service and its monthly $10 Stadia Pro service. It's unclear how many, if any, exclusive games will still come to the service, though the company has indicated that it can still sign new games and will bring more third-party releases to the platform. It nevertheless will look to many like a drawdown of the plan to have Stadia run as a bona fide competitor to console platforms. So.
Yep.
Yep.
Nope. Gone. Done. All right. Well, that is it, unless you had any other final closing thoughts or wanted to squeeze in another story. But other than that, we're pretty much at time. So why don't we spend this time reminding the watchers and listeners where they can find us.
Go to 80bitpodsmash.com. That's where our landing website is for all of our podcast platforms, as well as our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Reddit, and Twitter. You can find all of our stuff there. Our YouTube channel, this video will go live on YouTube. But the most important thing for you folks to do is to hit the subscription on twitch.tv/80bitpodsmash so you can be made aware.
Or YouTube, because most, I would say, we get, you know, in reviewing when we see people watch this, we don't have a lot of people watching it live, obviously, hence why there's not much conversation. But I do notice that either people watch it in like on the Twitch replays, or they watch it on YouTube later. So if that's how you're consuming this, which chances are you are, then there is a bell. There's a bell somewhere. There's a button somewhere you can subscribe so that you get alerted when new content is available on either YouTube or Twitch.
Yep. So hit those. So. Make sure you stay up to date with us through our social media platforms, and you can always reach out and interact with our audience across any of those platforms as well. We would love to have you. There's a Discord server. That link is in all of our show notes of our podcast, as well as our website. So go check out our Discord server. Jump in and start talking about video games and the things that you love with our audience.
Yeah. All right. There is a new episode going live. There is a episode that just went live on puzzle games. There's an episode next week going live on video game romance systems. So Monday situation there, and then Wednesday Termite is streaming, so tune in.
Lots of content for 80-bit Pod Smash. And I think Valentine's Day is not next Monday, but the following Monday.
It's after next Monday's episode.
Right. What comes out this Monday on the 8th? Game
what?
Testing. We have a whole episode about video game testing. That's 1 week from today. Comes out. That's the next
one.
Sorry.
Yeah, not the next. Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. Game testing. I always forget what episode we recorded.
Yep.
testing. We have an episode of game testing next Monday. The following Monday is our Valentine's Day on romance systems.
Yes. So now you know our next two episodes. You have no excuse not to hit our podcast platforms and subscribe on whatever platform of your choice to make sure your phone is loaded with the latest episode of 80-Bit Pod Smash.
Ready to go.
See you next week.
Bye.